Good, good singing this morning. Brother David.
You to join us in singing this song called Take Me In. We did this a while back on the Wednesday night group, so the Wednesday night crew will be a little bit familiar with it. The object of the song, real quick, what it's referring to, and you'll catch on to it in just a second, is back in Old Testament times in the temple, there was a veil which separated the common person from the spirit and the presence of God. And only one person was allowed to go in there to be in the presence of God once a year at their Day of Atonement. But when Jesus died on the cross, you'll remember the scripture says that the veil was torn. It was torn open so that we can all, and we don't have to go to a temple to do it. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives inside of us, and we have access to God all the time. That's what the song is talking about. So join us, and we're singing. It's the same thing twice. So if you stick with us through the first one, and if you need to, and then just come in on the second one, it's the same thing. All right. You may have noticed that I left my title off of the screen a while ago and just had the scripture references up because I didn't want to, and there it is now, I didn't want to give away the title to the message too soon because everybody would be wondering what is behind this blanket right here. The title of the message this morning is almost a trivia question. what do instruction manuals, food, and edge and weapons have in common? Have you ever seen swords in church? I want to show you each of my examples up here in brief and see if you can detect a commonality between them. So first, let's begin with some instruction manuals that I have over here. Many of you can see I have the Ultimate Survival Manual, which helps me to survive in the wilderness. I've got a few others. I got a robot vacuum instructions, pressure cooker, air fryer, how to grill. It's kind of an inadvertent food theme. And my favorite instruction manual that I have is this old Boy Scout handbook that I found at a garage sale. This is a Boy Scout handbook from 1959. So this told you how to be a Boy Scout the way they did it back in 1959. So instruction manuals. And what about this this good spread of food that I have up here? I've got some pancakes, some spaghetti sauce, some rolls that I've already been in trouble with for sneaking them out of the house, and some various other let's make believe that it's all highly nutritious things, and that nourish our bodies. Maybe pancakes aren't the best, but hey, they're good. But I wanted to show you something before I did that, and I forgot. You ever heard somebody say that they've got a life verse, something they picked out of the Bible that they is going to be the theme of their? I think, and with food in mind, I think I found my life verse, Isaiah 55. It said, "Wherefore do you spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfies not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness." Hey, it's in the Bible. All right, look, I've heard this many times, probably in my wilderness survival manual there somewhere as well. I've heard this: you can go 3 minutes without air, 3 days without water, 3 weeks without food. Not that you would necessarily die on day 22 without food. You know, we know that Jesus fasted 40 days. Others have as well. But by 3 weeks, the average person will begin to seriously deteriorate. All right? So, unlike survival manuals and swords, we cannot survive long term without food, can we? It's crucial. I'd like to pretend that all food is great for us and highly nutritious because my favorites mostly are not. But it is our food that gives us calories that we need to produce and process into energy, vitamins that our bodies need to function. So food is a crucial thing. But now let's take a look at the swords. These are not my swords, by the way. These were loaned to me by two gentlemen who happen to have a good sword collection. And I don't know a whole lot about them. I know that this is called a katana. This is kind of a Chinese design, not in quality, but in this is what a Chinese sword will look like, and such as that. You know, you look at swords and you can kind of tell that some of them were made to use different ways. I know that a curved sword is intended for slicing, and a straight sword, for one thing, is intended for jabbing. All right, swords work differently that way. I wish I had a good example of the sword that was used mostly in the New Testament times that people would have been familiar with would have been the Roman gladius sword, which was a short, heavy, sharp, two-edged sword that would do a lot of damage when it was swung or stabbed. But a sword in the hands of a trained swordsman is a deadly and dangerous weapon. The sword does its job by doing damage. You know, there's not very many. I mean, you could probably chop wood or fillet a fish with one if you're really good, but they're made for destruction. When a sword is brought to bear, something is being separated from something else. All right, so there's a sword. So you may be thinking, you may be trying to figure this out, what's the commonality? You may be putting all this together and say, okay, he has manuals to tell him how to cook the food, which he'll kill with a sword. There's the connection, right? Well, that's plausible, but that's not where I'm going with this. Some of you may have already guessed that each of these objects represents things that are used in the Bible to describe itself, God's holy word. All right? I wanted to find a creative way to talk about the importance of the Bible this morning. And I hope the object lessons help the message to stick in our mind. One thing to remember, though, is this. These things are not perfect examples of the spiritual significance of the Bible. Each of these items has flaws. For instance, the thing about an instruction manual is it won't help you a bit if you don't use it to learn the information inside, right? My survival manual, if I took that thing and went out into the wilderness with me and set it down on the ground, it won't help me survive at all. Can't do anything by itself like that. It'll just sit there and let me freeze to death. It's not the manual, it's the information inside that helps. The problem with these instruction manuals is they're not perfect. Sometimes the things inside an instruction manual become dated, and what it tells us to do is not what we know by conventional wisdom is the thing to do anymore. Let me just give you an example of that. I'm going to read you something from the Boy Scout Handbook, 1959. This is what to do if you find your buddy has a snake bite. It says, if you have a snake bite outfit, tie the ribbon in it around the limb that is bitten, 1.5 to 2 inches above the fang marks. Okay, that sounds reasonable. That is between the marks and the heart. If you have no ribbon, make a constriction band by folding your neckerchief into a cravat bandage a couple of inches wide. Tie the band firmly enough to make the surface veins stand out, but not so firmly that you shut off the blood in the arteries. Then, open up the fang marks with shallow cuts using a razor blade of the snake bite kit or a sharp knife sterilized in a match flame. As soon as the cuts are made, start suction to remove the poison-filled blood in the bite. If you have a snake bite kit, use the suction cup. Otherwise, use your lips, spitting out and rinsing the mouth from time to time with water. You know, you always see in the cowboy movies when somebody would get a rattlesnake bite and they would cut them open and suck out the venom. Now we know better. Don't ever do that. You're sucking venom into your mouth. All right? But that was conventional wisdom in 1959 Boy Scouts. So a manual is only good if the manual is valid and the manual is from a trusted source. All right? Our food isn't perfect either, is it? You know, I was joking around about that just a minute ago, but you know, we can all overindulge, especially in unhealthy stuff. I've never heard anybody say, man, I got carried away on that celery last night. I just had too much. I couldn't stop. You know, nobody does that, right? Food's not perfect. Our food can go bad. One time, Layla and I got seafood baskets, all of the same stuff, except mine had oysters and hers didn't. She was fine. I went to the hospital with food poisoning. Food is flawed. Swords such as these are not perfect. Becca and I like to watch this show called Forged in Fire, where his amateur bladesmiths come on, and they come on the show and they make swords and knives and stuff. Neat show. And then they test them to see who does the best. And quite often in testing, a sword breaks. They hit something, ping, there goes the handle or the blade comes off and snaps. They call that a catastrophic failure, and the contestant is eliminated. But if a sword were to break on a battlefield, back when they used swords on battlefields, the soldier wielding it would be in dire trouble, probably would get himself killed. But let's go through each of these things again, looking at each from a spiritual standpoint. We're trying to make a connection there, a spiritual connection with the Bible, right? And we'll start with instruction manuals again. Well, you won't find the term instruction manual in scriptures, right? Not in there. But it is very clear that we are to take instruction from God's Word. I have a lot of scriptures to put on the screen today. We'll be looking at some from the Bible in a few minutes. But let's see, Romans 15:4 says, "For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we, through patience and comfort of the scriptures, might have hope." For our learning, a good instruction manual will include everything that you need to know to teach you how to do whatever the manual is covering. This is our manual, which will teach us everything we need to know about how to have a right relationship with God. It is true and it is complete. It was written for our learning. But like an unused instruction manual, we don't study it. We can't learn it. It doesn't go in automatically. It won't work like that. Now, I hope none of you do this, but there are plenty, an abundance of saved people who read along with the sermon on Sunday morning and then seldom, if ever, during the week, read any portion of scriptures. And I'm not trying to sound scolding, but if you apply that, if it fits, okay? I'm just telling you the truth. You cannot learn what we need to know unless we are in this book regularly. Preferably daily. Look at Joshua 1:8 with me. "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do all that is written therein." Day and night. Take a portion of scripture and see what you can learn about it. I'll show you 2 Timothy 2:15, well-known verse, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." Commentaries and study Bibles are a big help to go along with the word as we read it. See, it's one thing to read the Bible, and that's good. It's even better to study it, just to dig in there, see what you can get. I could recommend to you some YouTube channels where you can look up specific scriptures and hear them explained. There are plenty of ways to dig into the scriptures, to dig deeper. Anybody can do it. But be warned, the devil will not be pleased if you do so. He does not want you looking into the scriptures. And many of you already know, he'll throw distractions in, he'll tell you it's boring, he'll attack, or whatever he has to do to keep you out of this word. Because he doesn't want you to know how to have a victorious Christian life. And that is just what we can have if we learn the word. Anytime you talk about learning the Bible, you have to use these verses. 2 Timothy 3:15, "And that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which were able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Jesus Christ. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." It will teach us everything that we need to know if we get in it and learn it. What kind of things will we learn from our great instruction manual? I want to show you some words. Be going to Psalms 119, if you didn't already turn there, when it was on the board a while ago. I want to show you some words of a man dedicated to learning God's word, and that was King David. Psalms 119, 1 through 16. I'm going to put these on the screen as well. I want us to look into the word, into our pages, but on the screen, I've highlighted in every verse of 1 through 16. David points out something about the Word of God and something that he's learned and a part of it. So as we read through there, you'll notice I'm going to read it off the screen so that I can keep up with where I'm at. And he says, "Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with a whole heart. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. Thou hast commanded us to keep thy precepts diligently. See, all those things come from the word. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep thy statutes. Then shall I not be ashamed when I have respect unto all thy commandments. I will praise thee with uprightness of heart when I shall have learned thy righteous judgments. I will keep thy statutes. Oh, forsake me not utterly. Wherewithal shall the young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereunto according to thy word. With thy whole heart, with my whole heart, I have sought thee. Oh, let me not wander from thy commandments. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. Blessed art thou, O Lord. Teach me thy statutes. With my lips have I declared all the judgments of thy mouth. I have rejoiced in the way of thy testimonies as much as in all riches. I will meditate in thy precepts and have respect unto thy ways. I will delight myself in thy statutes. I will not forget thy word. And you can read through the Psalms and see many, many more examples of the value that King David placed on knowing the word of God. He describes it as the law of God. And the importance of knowing it and learning it and letting it direct his path and show him how to be a man after God's own heart, as he's described as. Thing is, I read in the Boy Scout handbook there a minute ago, and that information is outdated, right? The instructions in this book will never be outdated.
Amen.
Never. The word of our God will last forever. The power behind that is the author. Not the human authors, but the one who inspired the inspired word. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And his word will never, ever change. Let's move on to the food. Another fairly common description is that of the Bible being our spiritual food. Follow me on this. Jesus said this. Matthew 4:4, but he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Just a minute ago, we read all scripture is given by inspiration of God, right? The literal translation of inspired or inspiration of God is God breathed. This word was breathed from the mouth of God. If we are to live spiritually off of this nutrition of this word, that's what we're supposed to do. Look at 1 Timothy 4:6. He says, if thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of faith and good doctrine. Nourished, that's nourishing to us. Here's the neat thing about the word as our spiritual food. The nutrition level we get from it is always right for our nutrition. I mean, our maturity level. It applies to us where we're at. Let me show you three verses that show this progression. 1 Peter 2:2, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow by. We're brand new Christians. We need the easy stuff, the basics to learn. And Peter there describes it as the sincere milk of the word. 1 Corinthians says, and I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. I fed you with milk, not with meat. For hereunto you are not able to bear it, neither yet now are you able. And one more is from Hebrews 5:2. For the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. Paul in 1 Corinthians, and maybe Paul in Hebrews, are actually rebuking the recipients of those letters because they should have been beyond the baby milk stage and ready to handle the meat, the more advanced things of the word. So you see the progression there. We begin with that milk, and as we grow and learn and mature, it becomes meat unto us. Thing is, all that food's on the same table. It's the same word. The easy things and the advanced things come from the same place. unfortunately, there are a lot of people who are just content to stay in the middle stage because they don't want to grow. With age comes responsibility, both physically and spiritually speaking. Thing is, both milk eaters and meat eaters, we're all feeding from the same book. There's no beginner's Bible. There's no advanced Bible. As we mature, what we get out of our study time deepens. Like God is adjusting the nutritional level to give us just the right amount of what we need to grow. Like with the instruction manuals, if you don't use it, it does you no good. A table piled high with food gives no nutrition if it's not eaten. I'll show you this, Jeremiah 15. Thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart, for I am called by thy name, O Lord God of hosts. And did he really eat them? Is Jeremiah saying did he pick up a scroll and eat? That's figurative. He means he ingested, he took in the words of God, and it brought him joy. What happens if you go a long time without eating? I've been invested lately in watching this show called Alone. It's turning into a message about what Brother Dave watches on TV. But I'm watching. We watch this show Alone, and they take these people and they stick them out in the wilderness, and they're all by themselves. They even filmed themselves for the show, and they got to survive out there by themselves out in the wilderness. And inevitably, well, whoever stays out the longest wins at the end of the show. But inevitably, they can't find enough to eat. Even the best survivalists, they can't find enough, especially in winter, and soon they start getting weak. They get so weak that they can't do nothing but just sit there sometimes and just hope they can wait out the next person gets a little weird. You know, that's just an example. But one of the saddest sights to see is people who are really starving. You've seen pictures of that, videos of that, like the pictures of POWs returning from World War II. Out of those camps, you know, they're just skin and bones. Sometimes they're too weak to even walk and have to be carried out. That's what happens to us spiritually when we don't feed on the Word. And it sneaks up because we feel strong on the outside, but our spiritual resolve on the inside is suffering. When does the devil hit? When we're weak. Yeah, he hits all the time, but he will not miss an opportunity when we are weak. Here's one more thing I wanted to show you. I have to feed you. Not this food, but this food. Jeremiah 3 said, I'll give you pastors according to my heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. Best part is you never eat too much. It's never bad. Some of it may be hard for us to swallow. In some scriptures, it's even referred to as bitter. Because some of the message of the Bible tells us that a lot of people are going to face judgment and wrath. That doesn't taste good, but it's the truth. But when we consume it, we will see how God gave his Son to redeem a lost and dying world. And as he opens up to us a new and exciting things to learn, what we get is joy and strength from the Word. That brings us all the way back around to swords. You know, I'm not a collector of this kind of swords. They're cool. I just never really been into it. But I have started a little sword collection of my own. Right? If I were collecting this kind of sword, my goal would be to have authentic military swords. That's what I would be interested in. The cream of the crop for me would be to have one or more old swords which had actually been used in combat. The more beat up, the better. Especially if it was dug up from the ground on a historic battlefield. That would be just something neat. I think it would be awesome to hold the same weapon that a soldier used to defend his life or to attack his enemy. I began to collect some old swords. It's a little different. I collect old swords like these. I found both of these here to start my collection with. And if anybody has a claim to them, I'll pass them on. But otherwise, I'd love to keep them. This is an old Gideon Bible. I believe the copyright date on this is 1968. You can tell it's been well worn. The author back here in the back has noted how to lead a soul to Christ in his own handwriting. I wonder how many opportunities the person that carried this sword got to share that message of salvation with somebody. That's an awesome sword to have. Man, this one here is really special to me also. This has a name in it. This is from one of your past pastors, I believe. It says, James Phillips, March 12th, 1955. And this thing is filled with notes and directions and thoughts of the man of God who wielded this sword. That is a special, special thing. I'm preaching this morning out of a sword that belonged to my dad. Got his name engraved on the front of it. And it's only got a few notes in it before he passed it on to me, but he's got some at the house that are filled with them. I'm looking forward to inheriting one day and having the swords of my father in my collection. That's just some neat things. Let me show you some verses here. Look at these verses with me. Revelations 1:16, comparing the word to a sword. The description of Jesus, and he had in his right hand 7 stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shining in his strength. And this from Hebrews 4 says, for the word of God is quick. Now, that means fast, it means living. It's living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. We see a clear comparison between the word when it comes from the mouth of Jesus and a sword. I want to look back, I want to look at an example from the physical side where Jesus told the disciples, he literally told them to arm themselves, and then things get a little confusing. This is from Luke chapter 22. Then said he unto them, but now he that hath the purse, let him take it, and likewise his strip. And he that hath no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. Right? So Jesus told him to get a sword. I'm going to read something from the results of that in Matthew chapter 26, 51 through 53. You can go there with me if you want to. Matthew 26, 51 says, now this was when the soldiers, you'll recognize this, come up to take Jesus captive. And behold, 51 says, one of them which were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew a sword and struck a servant of the high priest and smote off his ear. Then Jesus said unto him, put up again thy sword into its place, for all they that take the sword shall perish by the sword. Thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? Now we know that was Peter, of course. It took his sword and smote off the servant Malchus's ear. Now, to be accurate, some scholars point out that the word for sword there covers a broad range of weapons. And the sword that Peter had was most not likely not the double-edged Roman gladius that was against the law for just the general public to be toting around one of those things, but was probably a shorter, curved sika, or even a large fisherman's knife, which makes more sense for Peter to have, all right? But here's my point. Why would Jesus tell them to have swords, then rebuke Peter for using it? It's not using the sword that's a problem, it's what you do with it. I think Jesus is telling the guys who would be in danger soon, you can use this to defend yourself, but I don't need mortal man to defend me. Jesus does not need mortal man to defend him with violence. And if you go down that road, he says, it will catch up with you. But those that use the sword will die by the sword. There's a right way and a right time to use your sword. But we have a sword that we are allowed and encouraged to use all the time. In Ephesians chapter 6, we find the well-known description of the whole armor of God. Each piece that we are encouraged to put on daily is a symbolic part of the character which must be in place to withstand the spiritual attacks that will come. The armor is for our defense. And only one part is mentioned as an offensive weapon, and that is from Ephesians 6:17. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Jesus has given us the use of his sword. When used properly, the word does something really amazing. I'm going to go back to Hebrews 4:12. Look at that last verse of the word is quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. Look at the highlighted part. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. What that means is the living, powerful word of God has a way of cutting through all the junk that keeps people from feeling the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Hard heart slices right through. Unbelief, right through. Fear slices right through it. But remember, when you yield a powerful weapon, you must be careful that you do not more damage than good. Somebody said, what do you mean, Brother David? Do no damage with the Bible? Remember, what did Peter get in trouble for? He used his weapon wrong. He attacked somebody with it. Jesus had to fix the damage. Many people have been turned away from Christ because of overzealous Christians attacking them with the word. The word is designed to cut its way in so that it can heal, not so that it can destroy. We must be careful how we use it. If most any of us took up a real sword, one like this, and ran into a battle with it, you know what we would do? Maybe we'd cut a few enemies, probably we would cut ourselves, and then we'd get killed. Because we're not Jedi. We're not Zorro. We're not trained to fight with a sword like that. The rest easy, adventurers. All of the fun is not lost. We do get to do battle with these swords. Absolutely. But on a different battlefield against a different enemy. There are some principles that we need to understand first. Number one, the trainer is God. Psalms 144 says, blessed be the Lord my strength, which teaches my hands to war and my fingers to fight. How does he teach us? With experience, with the guidance from the Holy Spirit, and an instruction manual on how to do it. The same thing that we use as a weapon teaches us how to use our weapon in that need. Number two, it is not to attack people. 2 Corinthians 10 tells us, for we walk in the flesh, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. We do our fighting on a spiritual plane. When the devil attacks, we have the right weapon to cut him down. And Jesus even demonstrated how to swing the sword correctly. When the devil tempted a tired and hungry Jesus in the wilderness, Jesus used his own sword to repel each of these attacks. Quickly, I want to show you his responses. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Jesus said unto him, it is written, again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And Jesus said unto him, get hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him alone only shalt thou serve. See, he used, when the devil came with temptation, he used a relative scripture to repel the attack. Can we do that? Yes, we can. If we know it, we have the word hidden in our heart to know it. You know what it says after that? The devil left. He is powerless against the true and living word of God. He cannot withstand it. We are instructed in the word to flee from temptation, but when it catches us, we are to resist the devil and he will flee from us. We resist him with Jesus' sword. If we could just learn how to swing it with confidence when temptation comes, it will never, ever fail. But if we don't use it, it's not much help. One more thing. There's a key to the word of God. There's a key to it. See, not everybody who reads the Bible can understand its true meaning. Not everyone who studies its page is filled with spiritual nutrition. Not everyone is allowed to wield the powerful living sword. 2 Corinthians 2:4 says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ who is the image of God, to shine upon them. It is hidden. It is locked to those who are lost. The key is a relationship with Jesus Christ. We'll have our song director and musician be making their way to the front for our invitation. That relationship with Jesus Christ is made possible by placing your faith in Him as Lord and Savior. And if you're here this morning, or if you're watching, you haven't yet had that relationship with Christ, then please don't go another day at the mercy of this world. He has paid the price. He has provided everything we need. Won't you decide right now to make Him the Lord of your life? There's a battle waiting just outside those doors. For some, it may have been a battle just to get here today. And you know what you're walking back into. Do not fear. Let me share you one more verse. David said unto his men, gird ye every man his sword. And they girded on every man his sword. David also girded on his sword. Strap on your swords, my friends. We will be victorious. Anything you need to do with God this morning, you need salvation, you need to pray, the altar's open, let's stand together and sing.